Hi there, I'm Daniel Seberg. As we continue with day two of IO Live, we find ourselves in the Google Maps sandbox, and I am joined right now by Mike from Envista. How are you, Mike?
Good to see you.
So talk to me a little bit about how you tapped into the Google Maps API. You're overlaying a lot of really civic information with regards to, say, city planning or construction. Give me an overview of what Envista is all about, first of all.
Sure. Envista is about putting business data for both our municipalities and utilities onto a geolocated map. In this case, we've used Maps Engine underneath to take some of their static data, including pipeline information, things like that, and overlay dynamic information. As you can see here, a project we actually highlighted brings up both the project information and the contractors that are working on it. So the unified collection of business data and geolocated data allows us to share it between utilities, municipalities, different departments, different audiences, including the public eventually.
And what is this hoping to solve, in a sense? I mean, previous to this, or if a city planner didn't have access to this information, you know, what might happen, confusion between different groups?
Yeah, the biggest thing we find is the data spread out across different organizations and different systems. This platform, the combination of Maps Engine and our own tool set allows us to provide the services to bring that information together. We talk about collaboration around geolocated assets, but it really comes down to being able to share the information between the people who need it, and in the end, try and solve some problems, like who's working on which project where, when's it going on, and what's it going to impact.
Can you give us a little bit of a sort of a closer view of what we're looking at on the
sure.
screen here?
Sure. If we look at it here, we have the straight solid lines here represents different projects by a particular gas company in this case.
Okay.
over here.
Yep.
The big area here is actually transmission lines, and that buffer zone is places where they have to be aware that if there's a facility like a hospital or a school that needs to be evacuated, they need to have coordination with the first responders and a plan to get it out of there, or get people out of there during an evacuation. So that information together allows them to do some planning when they have a project. What are we going to impact when we go into the ground? So that type of information is what's on the map, but they also have a lot of information. In this case, project information coming from the work management system, as represented down here, as well as the contact list, as I said, which subcontractors are actually working on this and who needs access to see the information for this particular project.
Walk me through what the development process was like for you guys.
Sure.
Any learnings you had along the way, something you want to share with other developers?
Yeah, I think the big thing is we saw Maps Engine back this time last year at I.O. And discovered that because it does such a good job of getting the base map and our custom data represented in the map and with great performance, regardless of scale, it was a great starting point for us, so we started there. And then on the browser side, we actually used the Maps API to do some, as I said, the dynamic drawing on top, gets us access to the information to do the coordination. So when we click on a feature here, for instance, we can get to the same information on the business side. So the ability to use both the back-end server services by Maps Engine and on the client side in the browser allows us to put together some pretty powerful tools for our application.
Where has this been adopted so far? I know you've got some use cases listed on your website, but
we just started. We have a handful of utilities that have agreed to start working with the platform for us. We have also have a number of cities that started working it, and because it's relatively new, we've had a lot of encouraging feedback about the ability to bring different parts together. So. We expect to have a lot of good success in the second half with it.
Cool. Thank you so much for
Great.
Giving us insights of this, Mike. Really
okay.
appreciate it. All the best.
Thank you.
We continue our tour in the Google Maps sandbox with Ben from this little-known school, Harvard, I think you called it? Harvard University. And a fascinating project that you've been working on called the Harvard World Map. Tell me a little bit about it from sort of a high-level overview, first of all. Explain to people what it's all about.
Sure. So the vision behind World Map is, what if everybody in the world could upload big geospatial data to the cloud, analyze it, overlay it, control access to it, and collaborate around it such that, you know, we can generate new knowledge. So why would Harvard want to open something like this up to the entire world to upload data to? Well, it turns out that most of the best data in the world isn't actually at Harvard. So build a great platform and people will come and use it, and everybody will win is sort of basically the idea.
Okay, fantastic. Well, let's just see an example. This is the actual World Map site, first of all, for people who want to, so people can actually upload their own mapping data if they'd like to their geospatial data.
Right, so anybody can come in here, create a map, and be brought into a blank template, start adding data layers in about five different ways. Uploading data from the hard drive, creating layers and digitizing online, uploading scanned maps and georeferencing them online using MapWarper. This was developed by a company called Entropy Free. It's an open source online georeferencing platform.
And then you've got an example, if you can pull up the Africa map. This is a researcher at Harvard who worked on this particular project?
Yes. So this was developed by a professor named Suzanne Blier, and she uses this to gather together in one place all of the sort of valuable map data sets on Africa. She's got hundreds of data layers here, from ethnicity to social conflict, health, historic mapping, transatlantic slave trade. This is ethnographic mapping for the continent.
Using Google Maps API.
Google Maps API is behind all of this.
Yep.
So down at the bottom here, you'll see one has a choice of lots of different Google Map bases.
And you can pick and choose which filters you'd like to render on the map. You can zoom into different regions.
Right. So all of these can be styled. There's a sophisticated styling interface here. You can overlay one with another. So this is ethnicities now overlaid upon population density, and we could zoom in and out, and this goes down to a very fine level of detail.
That's fascinating stuff. Now let's just move on to maybe the Twitter health trends that you were talking about.
Sure.
Earlier.
So Africa Map is sort of a typical mapping application that somebody's built from scratch without having to be a developer. This is kind of the future direction of World Map. This is a platform that's being called GeoOps. It was developed by Todd Mostock, who's a researcher at Harvard, together with us. This is about big data, big geospatial data on the web. Uses a couple of GPUs to make possible on-the-fly queries and heat map generation for 125 million tweets. So those are the tweets themselves.
So you can see them represented on the map there. Yeah, absolutely.
Do you mind if I do one query here?
Sure.
So let's try tornado.
So these are people tweeting about a particular event.
This is exactly references, say, to tornadoes.
Well, that's really cool stuff. So yeah. Ben, if people want to check this out, where can they go?
This isn't live yet.
But the original stuff we talked about,
everything else is live. Yeah. This will be live within a month.
Okay.
Yeah.
So worldmap.harvard.edu, though, is the
worldmap.harvard.edu.
Okay. Great. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
All right. Yeah. All right. We're joined now by Steve, who may be familiar to many folks, formerly with Reddit, now a co-founder and CTO with Hipmunk, a increasingly popular travel app for folks and a travel site where you can book flights and hotels. But today, we are, of course, going to focus on Google Maps and how you tie that in with people's hotel booking. So walk me through what we're looking at.
Okay, sure. So this is our main map display. And so what we have here is the search that we did in San Francisco for a weekend or two from now. As you can see, it's dominated by the map because we felt that knowing where you're staying is probably the most important thing, especially if you've never been to a city before. Just kind of intuitively seeing the geography, the lay of the land. We represent the hotels as dots on this grid here. And the reason we lay things out in the grid is if we had showed every hotel in the city, it would just be a big splotch of dots.
And you wouldn't get the relations to where
is, right? What's beneficial about the splotch of dots is that you can see kind of where big streets are. But on Hipmunk, we've kind of split the difference. And you can see, Lombard Street here is a popular neighborhood, and Fisherman's Wharf, and then, here the Tenderloin, or as we would describe the tourists, the hotel district. And that gives us a nice feel. And then what we do is we basically take the top 10 hotels as sorted by ecstasy, and we highlight those. So those are the hotels we think you should stay on, basically based on the area you're looking at, the price of those hotels, the quality and review scores.
And for people who know Hipmunk, that's a reference to the agony and ecstasy rankings. So yeah.
Right. When you do a flight search, we start by agony, and a hotel search is ecstasy.
Okay. So then, and these dots here, the other ones are represented as different colors. That's all tied
into
this ranking.
So we've basically got three kind of price buckets. The green are the cheapest hotels, the red are the most expensive, and the blue are the average ones. Now, you can filter these down if you just want to see, cheap hotels, for example. By default, we just show everything and we let the XTC sort do the rest. Now, what's cool about these buckets is it varies by city. What's cheap in San Francisco is, non-existent in New York City. And you know, the town I grew up in, Virginia, right? You know, $140 is probably the most expensive hotel you're going to find. So we try to give you a sense, though, of like what the value is. You know, are you paying the market rate or not, effectively?
Cool. Any offerings to other developers on the experience you went through using the Maps API?
Sure. I mean, there's something about the Maps API that are really, really nice. I mean, obviously the maps themselves work. You know, you get all this, you know, dragging and zooming and all that stuff for free. One of the cool features we added is heat maps. So we computed heat maps of all the like hot places to be in a city. Right now I have the food heat map turned on. And it's actually really cool. We just computed these tiles, name them with like a special format, and then Google Maps does the rest. You know, lays them out, loads them, you know, all the different zoom levels. It's actually really neat. And it's probably we got the most like bang out of that feature for like developer hours ever, right? It was actually really simple to do, but it looks really, really awesome. And that's really cool. There's some other stuff we do. Actually, I'll turn on my calendar here. This integrates with my Google Calendar, which is another Google API. And then I can show in the city like where I need to be. So if you're a business traveler and you've got things to do, you can actually see.
That's very handy. Yeah. So you could almost know if you need to walk or you could just walk somewhere.
And if I click the sort by distance here, I can choose, you know, one of my events and it'll show me just hotels, you know, near that event. Or it'll take the hotels near that event and then sort them by ecstasy.
That's fantastic. All right. Well, Steve, thank you so much. Full disclosure, I used Hipmunk to find my way here from
perfect.
New York. So
perfect.
Thank you so much for that demo. Appreciate
all right,
it.
Sure.
And we finish up our tour in the Google Maps sandbox with Peter, who is the product manager with Google Earth. And in a sense, we're going to get our own personal helicopter tour here, right?
Absolutely. So we're really excited. Yesterday here at I.O., we announced the launch of this new 3D imagery technology in Google Earth for Android devices. And you can actually, behind us here, we have a demonstration showing what some of this imagery actually looks like in what we call our Liquid Galaxy, which is this great way
cool
to view this
display.
Data.
Yep.
But what's going on here is that, you know, Google Earth has been around for a long time. We've been doing 3D for years.
Right, people are already familiar with 3D buildings, maybe the 3D warehouse or something, but now...
Absolutely. So now what we really realized was that we needed to step it up a notch, right? We really needed to increase the scale, the consistency, and the coverage of the 3D buildings. And we just really needed to figure out how to notch it up. And so what we're doing is we have this new 3D imagery where we're actually using aerial imagery from planes where they shoot four different angles.
Very specific patterns that they have to fly, right? To
exactly.
Gather all this.
So we shoot basically forwards, back, left, right, and then straight down. So there's a fifth shot that's straight down. And then from that, we're able to automatically generate 3D data. So the things you're looking at here is all auto-generated using something called stereophotogrammetry, where we're actually using the different images to extract the 3D data. And then we actually take that and we texture it, or you know, we sort of color the geometry with the actual photos.
I almost think of it as like digital sculpting or something, but it's pretty amazing looking.
Yeah,
resolution.
I mean, it's something that it's phenomenal how far the technology has gone, and have being able to have the resources of not only the talented engineers at Google, but also the infrastructure that we have that allows us to build 3D models at this scale. Automatically.
All right, now we're seeing this on bigger screens thanks to Liquid Galaxy, but in your hand you've got a tablet, and so folks can check this out in a mobile way both for tablets and phones as well.
Absolutely, and what I have right here, this is a Motorola Zoom tablet, and I don't know if your viewers will get the best view of this, so the best way for people to check this out is to download it onto your Android device, whether it's a phone or a tablet. It's supported on multi-core phones, so for example, the great Galaxy Nexus, as well as Samsung Galaxy 2, and the new 3, and a bunch of other devices, as well as obviously the new Nexus 7, which we just released. Works fantastic on that as well.
And coming soon to iOS, if people are curious.
And it is coming soon to iOS as well.
Okay.
So. Here you can see I'm actually going through San Francisco. We've launched about a dozen or so cities and metro areas, including San Francisco, LA, Portland, Rome, Tampa.
And many more to come.
Many more to come. We got Charlotte. We've got a bunch more. And we've stated that we're going to have the communities of over 300 million people covered by the end of this year, and we're going to just keep going from there. So we're really excited about being able to bring this kind of 3D technology to people around the world.
And I'm sure lots of folks will look forward to a desktop version at some point.
Coming soon.
Coming
as well.
Coming soon, sure.
Later this year.
Peter, thank you so much for
this
tour. We're going to land our helicopter now here in the Google Maps sandbox. Stay tuned for lots more here on IO Live.